Good evening.
Welcome.
Welcome, Crossroads.
Yes.
We are so excited that to see everyone here tonight, both in the audience as well as at home. We want to say thank you so much
thank
for having you.
You
here. This is our Crossroads Marriage Ministry,
yes.
And you have found our last lesson of our Endless Love series.
Yes.
We're so excited. But you know, I feel a certain kind of way because this is our last lesson.
I know.
For that means for the past 3 weeks, every Wednesday we've been talking about marriage and
love
and promises,
yes,
and
passion.
Yes.
And God and the church.
Yes, yes. So we're just so excited to be here. This is our last lesson. We're going to miss each and every one of you,
yes.
But we do have some surprises during this episode, so please pay attention. You know, actually, I think one of those surprises is right here.
Yes,
like
we dressed up.
Yeah, don't we look nice? Come on, come on, come on. We need a hand cap. This is fantastic. Yes. So
we wanted it to look like a wedding ceremony.
Yes, yes. You know, marriage is as holy as it is. We definitely want to make sure that people understand how solemn it is, how important it is, and how fun that it can be. And
exactly.
So this is our reason for being dressed this way. Absolutely. So shall we mention and talk about our Bible verse for our marriage ministry?
Yes, we should. On the next slide.
Yes. Yes.
The cord, right?
The threefold cord.
Yes, yes.
All right, here we go. Three strands.
One flesh.
All right, so here's the Bible verse, Ecclesiastes 4:12. And a threefold cord is not easily broken. Woo, that is fantastic. And again, this is a constant reminder,
yes,
to everyone that in every single marriage, we are inviting the Holy Spirit into that marriage. It's just so important and so key because husbands don't know it all. Wives don't know it all, but God knows it all. And so we definitely need his help in any marriage. And so we just invite him right now,
yes,
to speak through us and to open our hearts.
Remember,
awesome,
we said that God created marriage to be holy, and he gave us a holy Bible to use, right?
Yes, he did. And so we definitely need to use it. The next slide, you're going to see a very, very special picture. And this is a picture on our wedding day, isn't it? Woohoo! I don't know if I was hesitating for the camera or if I was just shy and kissing you. I don't know. I don't know. But anyway, there it goes. We're just so excited. That was how many years ago? At least 25 years ago in December. We're just so excited about, you know.
Almost 26.
Yes, yes, it's coming up.
December,
that's,
yes,
right. Ooh, so that is fantastic. You know, some marriages, couples, they keep a portion of their wedding cake.
That's
and
right.
And they share into that wedding cake maybe a year later.
At their
or
1 year anniversary.
At their 1 year anniversary. Mm-hmm. And so it's always great to kind of remember those traditions. And part of that tradition is to, you know, go back and look at the video of your marriage. I mean,
yes,
we've done that before, and it's just so wonderful. You don't have to wait till your anniversary to do so.
No.
Sometimes this might be helpful to remind, you know, ourselves, hey, this person who I married is the one that I chose,
yes,
the one that God meant for me, and the one that I love. And so, mm-hmm, so we're just
and
excited
cherish
about that and cherish. Absolutely right.
I just put our wedding videos, both of them, in the shop. They were still on VHS tape. That's how old we are.
Yeah, you
and
know.
And we wanted to show them, but it takes 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So to come back.
So you all missed out on seeing our wedding
video.
So
we'll have to do it again when we have it on DVD.
That gives us an excuse to have another lesson.
Yes.
How about that? You can't get rid of us. You can't get rid of us.
No.
Anyway.
Because we have two wedding videos to show you.
Absolutely, absolutely. All right. Shall we get into the lesson?
Yes.
All right. So
tonight we're going to share a secret recipe, right, for a godly marriage.
Yes. And there are four parts tonight of this new lesson. And again, the lesson is putting it all together,
yes,
the secret recipe that God has for our marriage. And boy, you are in for a treat. So sit back, listen. Take notes if you want to. This is going to be fantastic, all right? Here we go. So part one is seeking God and praying for your mate. That's part one. Part two is passionate marriages in the Bible. We're going to review the couples that we talked about in lesson one, in lesson two, and in lesson three. We're going to talk about those just to kind of remind folks what we were emphasizing when we talked about them. And then ways to reignite the flame. That's what this is about. Part two, ways to reignite the flame.
In part three, we're going to review God's promises. Remember, we went over all the many names of Jehovah and how God promises us so much, whether we're single or married. His promises remain true, right? He is the only one true God, right? And he reigns. He's our matchless king. And then in part four, we're going to talk about a recipe for a godly marriage, the secret recipe.
Oh, boy.
And it's found in Ephesians 5 if you want to get a head start.
Oh, wow. Well, I want to learn about that secret recipe.
Okay. And then in the end, we're going to talk about the future for Crossroads Marriage Ministry. What are the plans that we have?
Yes, we have one special event that we're going to share with you. It's going to come very, very soon. We'll share that with you at the end. So again, as I said before, be aware, take note, there will be some surprises during this episode. We're not going to tell you. All right, here we go. Part one.
Yes. So part one says, seek God and pray for your mate, right? You're going to seek God by spending time in his word. You're going to read his word and discover who God made you, who he created you to be. Your identity is in God, right? He knows your innermost thoughts. He knows every part of you. He knows you, how intricate you're designed. He created you with feelings, with ideas, with passions, with desires. He knows all about what you need, right? And he's quite able to give you exactly what you need in a mate.
Yes, absolutely. And I do seem to remember that God thinks that a mate that he blesses us with is a gift. In fact, the scripture says, Proverbs 18:22, he who finds a wife or a husband finds a good thing and receives favor from the Lord. So finding a spouse is really a blessing. And what it really means is that God is really looking down on you and really, really blessing you. He's favoring you. He's really raising you up. And it's just such a wonderful, beautiful gift. It really is.
Yes. And you're also going to align your goals with God's goals, right? Prioritize what's important, right? That's what you should spend your time doing. Honor your mate before you even know them, right? And even when you do know them, you're supposed to honor them in everything that you do.
Yeah, and you know, one key component of this part of the lesson is that four-letter word, pray. It is just so important. And you know, as Relisha was talking, I was thinking of an example in our lives. You know, when we take those vows, it says in sickness or in health.
Yes.
And you know, we can never predict the future, and there may be times where one of us may be sick, or even both of us. So in this example, there was a time where my wife, Relisha, she became very sick, and you know, she was in the hospital, and I remember just feeling so helpless. The way the story goes is that she was in the hospital, she had undergone a procedure for her lungs. She had asked me to leave to kind of go home to check on the kids. And I heard the Lord speaking to me saying, Ted, you need to get back to the hospital as quick as you can. And boy, it is so important to have that Holy Spirit speak to you, because God was exactly right. I fed the kids in a hurry, ran back to the hospital. And what I found was my wife, when I left her, she was in the bed. The hospital bed. When I arrived, she was in a chair, and she was not speaking. She was near unconscious, and her body temperature was freezing. And when I touched her and tried to wake her up, she said to me, I'm so hot, I'm so hot. And what had happened is that her blood pressure had sunken down to like 50. And we're talking in the 50s. Normal blood pressure is what? 110 over 80 or 110 over, you know, 70. She was in her 50s. The point that I'm trying to say is that God spoke to me to get to the hospital right on time for my wife. And if I had not been in a prayerful mood and opening up myself to hearing the voice of the Lord, I just don't know. I don't want to even think about what could have happened.
And but that was 2018.
Yes,
and
yes.
And praise God, I'm here.
Yes, he is here. So I quickly rallied the nursing staff, rallied the doctors, and of course, I did chastise them a little bit. Don't mind that. God forgive me. But the bottom line is that they came to our rescue, yes. And they were able to kind of restore Relisha. And never again did I leave by her side. But you know, this is so important, is that we need to pray for our spouses, not just when something bad is happening, but all the time. And for me, it's a constant reminder that, you know, another way to strengthen your marriage, another way to strengthen your spouse, and even strengthen yourself, yes. is to pray for one another. And that's just so important.
And I'm so grateful that he came.
I am too, absolutely.
In Titus, it tells us in the NIV, Titus chapter 2, you, however, must teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. Verse 2, teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love and endurance. Verse 3, likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderous or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Verse 4, then they can urge the younger women to love their husbands and children. Verse 5, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, and to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Verse 6, similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled. Verse 7, in everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, verse 8, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. The reason why I chose this scripture was because it talked about doing good, and God showed us that marriage is good, even though the world says that marriage is not good. There's so many opposing views and factors to why people should not get married, but we are here today to tell you that marriage is good.
Marriage is good. Say it again. Marriage is good. Absolutely.
Marriage is better than good. It's
yes.
great.
Yes. And we know because of experience. But anyway, marriage is good. Look, as Relisha was talking, I was just thinking, you know, there is a message in the scripture that she read for both men and women and husbands and wives, and also husbands-to-be and wives-to-be.
Yes.
And the message is, you know, there is a responsibility that all of us have in terms of preparing ourselves
yes.
for marriage, in terms of how we live unto the Lord
yes.
even before marriage. So it's not just during the marriage, but also before. And what you do before the marriage really lays the groundwork for strengthening that marriage. So that's something that we definitely want to think about. Another verse in scripture talks about both sides, the husband and the wives,
yes.
submitting one to another. And that's just so important and so key, you know, and I think that needs to be talked about a whole lot more.
Yes. So on the next slide, part two, we are reviewing the passionate marriages in the Bible.
Wow, ways to reignite that hot flame. Woohoo!
I'm always reminded about how every time we had a baby, we're so in love with that baby, right? They're new, they smell good most of the time. They're just so cute and adorable. And we spend more time doting on that baby than we do our spouse who helped us make the baby, right?
Yeah, and you know, that's why it's so important that spouses need to remember to consider one another and to spend some alone time together as a couple.
Yes.
You know, we do that quite often with date night, and it's lovely. It's a time to kind of escape the, you know, escape the stresses of the day. It's time to, you know, get together and just take a big breath, a deep
yes.
breath, and say, okay.
We might go on a date tonight.
Oh, wow.
Since we dressed up.
Oh, well, you know what? That's a good idea. Surprise, surprise. Oh, that is fantastic. You know, it's going to be great. It's going to be great. So anyway, the point here is that, you know, this can be impromptu. You don't even have to plan it. So just like this one that we're going to have tonight. So the point is do, you know, try to find things that you both enjoy and just enjoy spending time with each other and never forget how it was when you first met.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. So we'll review Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve became spiritually separated from God when they sinned against him. They believed the lie of the enemy and were cursed, right? So at first they were given all these promises, and then they listened to the serpent, right?
Yes, they did.
And so sickness and sin and death crept in, right?
Yes. One more point I want to make about the Adam and Eve story. I encourage everyone to go back and read it. Something that I don't want you to miss, and that is God held Adam responsible. In fact, it was Adam who the Lord sought out to provide an answer for what happened. So men, husbands, be aware that we're responsible for the spiritual tone in your home. You're responsible also for the spiritual maturity of your children and also of your family. So I just want to make sure that we understand that. It's a responsibility that we have to own up to. It's a responsibility that we have to do. We can do it jointly, but ultimately, men, husbands, are to answer to the Lord.
Yes. Amen. And here in John 10:10, it says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." So even though Adam and Eve sinned, God came back and redeemed them. Right?
Yes, he did.
He sent his son to redeem them.
Yes, he did. He did it for all of us through Jesus Christ,
Amen.
And we're just so excited about that.
Yes.
The next couple that we discussed was Sarah and Abraham. And what did we say about Sarah and Abraham? We said that they had an awesome promise.
They did.
It was really, really awesome because Abraham would be the father of many, 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 many nations. And Sarah would be the mother of
yes.
many, many, many nations since she was married to Abraham. But the point that I'm trying to make is, you know, during that process, wow, it was so hard. It was hard because the promise was so big that Abraham and Sarah, they both thought, wow, I just don't know how this can happen.
Especially at my age.
Especially at my age. I mean, Abraham is 100 and I'm 99, and I just don't know how this could happen.
Yes.
And the only way they thought that this could happen was by some action that they had to take. And that's where they went wrong.
Yes.
One of the points that we learned from Abraham and Sarah is that if God makes the promise, he alone will make sure that promise happens.
That's right.
And we don't need to worry about, you know, what we have to do, because all power is in him. And I think that's a great message to have learned from that story.
Yes, God doesn't need our help, right?
No, he doesn't need our help.
So it says, Abraham and Sarah's faith was tested as they aged, and they didn't see God's promise unfold. Hebrews 6:14 in the NIV says, saying, I will surely bless you and give you many descendants. 1 Peter 3, verses 5 through 6 in the NIV, for this is the way the holy women of the past who put their hope in God used to adorn themselves to their own husbands. Verse 6, like Sarah, who obeyed Abraham and called him her Lord, lowercase l. You are her daughters if you do what is right and do not give way to fear.
Yeah, you know, I think Sarah and Abraham reflect a great attitude, a great approach towards how one spouse should treat the other, whether it's the husband or the wife. I think the attitude, the approach is one of, you know, kindness.
Yes.
And the word that you use is very, very apropos, and that is cherish.
Yes.
Cherish each other. That's just so key. And we see that in this scripture. It's really awesome.
Yes.
Love it. Love it.
Time is so short. And can you imagine 3 years ago, something different could have been And you guys would have seen Teddy up here doing this with someone else.
Oh, right? I don't think so. No, I don't think that. That's not a good thought. But anyway, we'll move on because I'm blushing now, which is not a good thing for me.
Ruth and Boaz, right? Ruth taught us to have hope even if our spouse passes away, right? Our future is in God. Boaz redeemed Ruth just as Christ redeemed the church. Ruth was a widow, Naomi was a widow, Orpah was a widow,
yeah.
And Naomi told Orpah and Ruth, she said, go back home, right? Mm-hmm. But Ruth said, no, I'm not going anywhere, I'm going with you. Your people are going to be my people, and your God, my God,
yeah.
Right? And that faith helped her get a new husband.
Yes, yes, and you know what? The other benefit of this story is to recognize the power of your words.
Yes.
And in fact, when Ruth was making that declaration, she was taking that stand that I talked about earlier about who she was going to stay with for the rest of her life, about which God that she was going to serve for the rest of her life, about which people who she was going to be with for the rest of her life. Guess what? God also heard her as well. And God rewarded that faithfulness and that declaration. And I think that's just so important, is that our words have power. And that, yes, too, God hears every word that we utter. So that's a great reminder. And he's looking to reward us for the things that we stay and stand behind.
Amen. Yes. Yeah. And I'm thinking about how Ruth has her own chapter in the Bible.
Yeah.
So does Esther. So she's another person who we could have talked about, and her influence to save her whole people from death.
Yeah.
By the King Xerxes.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So it's awesome that we have these examples in the Bible.
Yeah, great women who God saw fit to reward. And again, having your own book in the Bible by your name, that's another reward.
Yes.
So what she did really, really made a huge difference.
It did.
So really awesome, awesome.
And then we have Priscilla and Aquila. This was the new couple that we talked about last week. They were church planters and tent makers.
Yeah.
Right?
They were.
And they also were missionaries alongside Paul.
Yes, and you know, their heart was to bring people into the kingdom of the Lord.
Yes.
And they did it by, you know, showing the true example of what it means to be a married husband and wife.
Yes.
Doing marriage God's way.
Amen.
And this is
a strong marriage.
Yes, a strong marriage there. And the reason why this is so important, and we talked about this verse, and you know, what this goes to is every marriage is a microcosm of really how God loves his church, his people. And another word for his church and his people is his bride.
Yes.
So we are God's bride. And so, you know, God's desire is that every marriage reflect that love, reflect that trust, reflect those rewards. And so this is exactly what happened.
Yes. I have here, Priscilla and Aquila are a unified couple who preach the gospel with Paul. They are passionate missionaries and church planters with a strong marriage, right?
Yes.
Romans 16:3-4 in the NIV. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my co-workers in Christ Jesus. They risk their lives for me. Not only I, but all the churches of the Gentiles are grateful for them.
Awesome, awesome. Mm-hmm. You know, as you were talking, you know, I love this scripture, but as you were talking, I'm going right back to the title. So, Relisha, I'm going to ask you, what are other ways to reignite the flame?
Well, we're going on a date.
Yeah, we're going on a date, but I mean, I want to hear more. Listen. Other ways to reignite the flame is maybe to do hobbies together.
Oh, yes.
You know, something that you both enjoy.
Learn something new together.
Set new goals and strive to achieve those goals together.
Yes.
All types of ways. And of course, you know, there's other ways too as well that God has provided within the confines of marriage. And
so
they're wonderful, wonderful, wonderful ways. Yes.
Okay, moving on to part three.
Review God's promises
with all the many names of Jesus.
The many names of Jesus. And we talked about this. And what I want to say about this, because I want to make sure this point gets across, is that these are not just names of God. When we review the names of God, what should get across is that these names are the very embodiment of who God is. They are who he is. Way back when Moses asked God, he said, "Lord, what shall I tell Pharaoh when he asked me who sent me?" And his answer, God's answer to Moses was, "Tell them that I am sent you. And so whenever we see these names of God, we should really be saying, "I am." You know, God is Jehovah.
Yes, he is.
God is Jehovah Jireh, and so on and so on. That's just such a very important point.
And God has been all of these names and more to us.
Yes,
he
yes.
He really has over yes. the past. And we believe that he's going to continue showing himself the one true matchless king, right?
He yes,
reigns.
Yes.
And he reigns forever.
Absolutely. And these promises are open to individuals, and also they're open to couples. So we can draw on these promises and meditate and pray on these names of God, because this is what God wants. This is his desire, is to know him fully and completely.
Amen. Yes. And then we go on to part four.
Part four, the last part.
I can't believe it.
Are we getting to the end of lesson four? Wow.
Now, part four, this is kind of funny, right? Is it up there yet? Part four is the recipe for a godly marriage. There's a secret recipe. And I think I forgot to add in something, right? Do you want to read the recipe?
Well, I want to know what you forgot to add in.
I'll tell you at the end.
Okay. Is it something that we should be talking about in front of the audience?
Yes.
It is?
Yes.
Okay, so that means it's safe then.
It is.
All right, good. All right. So we're going to talk about these ingredients. Part four, boy, look at this. I'm going to just read a few down. This is really awesome. So let me see. This says a stupendous amount of hope. That's awesome. It says one handful of praise as needed. Oh, that's really great. 12 teaspoons of teamwork. Oh, yeah, we definitely need teamwork in marriage. Loads of hugs. I love that. A million kisses per day. I love that too as well. Let me see. 24 and a half cups of consideration. Yeah, that's true. We got to remember that half. That's true. That's so important there. Let me see. What else? You got 6 prayers per day or as needed. That's good. Oh, liberal amounts of peace. Oh, boy. Boy, do we need peace in a marriage sometimes. So, yes, we need liberal amounts of peace. That's really awesome. Let me see. Anything else on this list that sticks out to you?
I forgot to add some laughter.
Laughter. You know, I thought you were going someplace else with that.
No.
But
the Bible tells us that laughter does good like medicine,
yes,
right?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
Sometimes we need medicine when we're married.
Yeah, absolutely right.
The marriage needs laughter.
Yes, absolutely. So, and the other thing also that you have is a humongous amount of passion. So I do like that, because that kind of gets to where I was going, right? You know, the passion. Without saying it, it's the passion. So it is in there. I'm glad to see that it's in there. I think we all know that it's in there. So that's good.
All right, instructions, right?
Yes.
Mix each ingredient into your heart slowly. Bake at 450 degrees for 24 hours until tender.
Tender? You mean the heart.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
Yeah. Heart is tender.
Be sure to use careful amounts of understanding, acceptance, and commitment to ensure proper results.
Yes.
Results may vary based on each couple. Keep warm with spicy passion. There's your word.
passion, that's my word.
Reheat with steady flames as needed. Proverbs 27:17.
No comment.
NIV. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another.
Yeah, you know, this is such a beautiful representation of what a marriage should look like. And you know what? Make no mistake. You know, there's no perfect marriage because you have two imperfect people in that marriage. However, with God, all things are possible.
Amen.
And if you invite the Holy Spirit into that marriage, then that marriage will be awesome. And so I think the Holy Spirit can help us find and acquire some of these ingredients to kind of make the recipe that we want in that marriage. And so this is a perfect picture of how to do that, of some of the things that we might need in that marriage. And we can only get those ingredients from the Lord. And by reading and learning, you know, through His Word, and also by time in prayer, you know, spending time with the Lord, He will fill our hearts with these types of ingredients and make the recipe work. And so I think that's just
only God can make us whole, right?
Yes.
If we put all these ingredients together in a pot, it's not going to make a beautiful wedding cake, right?
No.
It's not going to be something we can eat if it's baked for 24 hours.
That's right. And on top of that, as you know, when you cook a cake, you got to put in ingredients at the right time.
Yes.
So this brings to mind that...
Otherwise, you have a dump cake.
That's right, which is a horrible, horrible cake. But this brings into mind that, you know, this is the reason why sometimes God, it may look like God is taking His time in answering our prayer, but you know what? It's the right time. And only He knows the right time. And so
because
that's why it's so important.
The right person just for you.
Yes, absolutely right. Mm-hmm. So that's a very, very key point.
Yes.
Wow. Excellent.
But true
excellent.
Love waits, right?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
I remember we did a purity class with our older two children.
We did.
And that was the title of it, True Love Waits.
Yeah.
And we actually had to speak, right?
Yeah, we did. I remember that.
And it was like 11 years ago.
Yeah, it was really great. And really what we provided was just information about, you know, telling kids, you know, how they could present themselves as a gift to their spouse.
Yes.
And they could present their best selves to their spouse. Number one, but also more importantly, how they could live as unto the Lord, as how God would want us to live. You know, sometimes we can get, you know, burdened and dragged down by all the different distractions in this world. And sometimes those distractions, they kind of stick to you, and it's hard to let go of those things, right? And you bring those into a marriage. Some people call it baggage or maybe, you know, any other word that you want to choose. But the bottom line is that the less of that you have, the better that marriage will be.
Yes.
And sometimes it is our choices that kind of, you know, brings on that baggage. And so if we could just think about the choices that we make when we're single and when we're married, then we'll have less of that to deal with. And it'll be a lot easier, I think, in the marriage there too as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. Less drama.
Less drama.
Don't want that like Sarah and Abraham.
No, all right. But this doesn't mean that God can't come into that marriage, come into your life, and make things work out. Because there's a scripture that says, all things work together to them that love the Lord. And so God, even in that circumstance, God can still make a difference. So I want to make sure that that's clear to you as well.
Yes, and only God can create someone just for you.
Yes.
Right? To love forever. And you can have an endless love.
Yes, an endless love, which is a great way to end our endless love series. And it goes back to our talk about Adam and Eve and how God made that perfect help meet for Adam. Just for him. Meet means just for him. So when you pray and ask for a spouse, God will answer that prayer by blessing you with somebody who is just for you. And that's just simply, you know, just simply fantastic. In this love series.
I know.
You know what? I don't want this to end.
I know.
I don't want it to end. But you know what? We did say we have some surprises.
Oh, yes. On the next slide, there's going to be a big surprise.
Oh, look at this. Yay.
Yes.
Date night.
We have a date night.
Yes.
Coming up.
Can you believe it? There's another date night. It's been so long. Oh, it's been so long.
I don't think we've had a date night in about 2 years.
2 years.
For Crossroads.
Yes.
I mean, we have
we have plenty of dates. In fact, we have one tonight.
We have one tonight.
Yeah, I'm not going to let you forget that. We have a date night tonight. I'm holding her to that. But anyway, yes.
So on October 30th, from
4 to 6
p.m.
Yes, yes.
We're going to have a pizza and paint night.
Yes.
We're not painting pizza.
No, we're not painting pizza.
And we're not painting with pizza.
We're going to be eating pizza,
we're
though.
We're going to eat the pizza.
Lots of it, too.
Yes.
A lot of pizza.
Eating the pizza.
It's going to be
and
good.
Do a directed drawing painting.
Yes.
One per couple. So
yes.
You're going to be painting together.
Yes. That's awesome.
Yes. And so I don't think I have the right email address. It's crossroadsag.net/connect is where you're going to go.
Yes.
So
yes.
I think I put connect at.
Yes.
That's not right. But you can go to the website crossroadsag.net.
Yep.
Ag.net and RSVP, we would love for you to RSVP before October 27th so that we have a count of the couples, and it's only $5 per couple to cover the pizza. We're
yes.
going to cover the paint.
Yep.
You cover the pizza, we cover the paint.
And this is a great opportunity for couples to create passion
yes.
through art, through painting. So
yes.
this is really awesome.
To connect, to bond,
yes.
to kind of chat with other couples.
Yes.
And
so we will provide
build some memories.
Yes, build some memories. We'll provide more information about location and,
yes.
and this and that, but it will be awesome. We welcome anyone, everyone who's interested to come on out. It's going to be great.
For and, married couples.
Yes, for married couples. It's very awesome.
Because we're going to talk about married couples.
Yeah,
topics.
Yeah, yeah. Or maybe those engaged. Who are engaged
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, those who are engaged.
True.
That's really awesome. So this is really great.
Yes. So that was a surprise.
Yes.
And then we're going to pray.
Yes, we are going to pray. But before that, I want to ask you about what's going on up here with all the designs and stuff, and like what is going on?
Well, we have a We Still Do sign.
Okay.
And then we have the three candles for the two of us
uh-huh.
and Jesus.
Okay.
Sparkling because we're going to take communion tonight.
Okay, so this is sparkling grape juice.
Yes.
Okay, sparkling grape juice,
mm-hmm.
and we're going to take communion
yes.
tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Before our day.
Yes, before our day. This is really awesome. You know, on a serious note, we thought it would be, you know, so special and so important to remind couples that as we take communion, it is a representation of Christ in the church. You know, we did that 25 years ago at our wedding. On our wedding day, we took Holy Communion to represent the fact that God was uniting us as one, but at the same time, there's an expectation, there's a hope, if you will, for all Christians that one day that he's coming back to retrieve his bride,
yes.
and his bride is us. So we're excited about that, and so I think taking Holy Communion within the marriage is very, very important, and so we're going to mark the close of the Endless Love series with
communion.
Taking communion after this is all over. So you won't be here. However, we will be taking it after this is over with. If you feel free,
you
if you
want to
take it. And we'll know spiritually that we have other couples that are also doing the same thing right after this is over with. So this is just fantastic. Yet one more surprise that we have today.
After the prayer.
Yes, we have one more surprise after the prayer. So stay tuned. After we pray, do not leave. You will be so surprised. Actually, I might be more surprised than the viewers. But anyway, this is good. Yes, you want to pray? Yes, we can.
Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your love and your goodness, your kindness, your mercy. Lord, you are so faithful, and you've brought us to a close of this Endless Love series where we were able to get to know you better and to know more about how you feel about marriage. Thank you, Lord, for all those people who hope in you and trust in you. Lord, for those people who need to be revived and reminded about
yes, Lord.
What you have spoken about
yes,
marriage. Lord.
Lord,
help them to know that you love them and that
yes,
you created
Lord.
Them with the desire to be married and to have a godly marriage.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, for the single people, continue to allow them to hold on and have hope in you.
Yes,
help
Lord.
Them to know that their waiting is not in vain
yes,
and that true love waits.
Yes.
That
yes.
you've done so much for us. You sacrificed so much just so that we could be yours.
Mm. Yes, Lord.
We love you, Lord, and we thank
we love you.
You.
Lord, Father, we love you. We thank you. You are so awesome. You're so great. Lord, we know that when it comes to true love waiting, we know that you have been waiting for us for so long. In fact, you sent your son, Jesus Christ, your only son, to die for us while we were yet sinners. We didn't know you, and we didn't even care to know you. So, Lord, we thank you for the time that we spent the past 3 weeks talking about the purpose of marriage, and then moving on to talk about the passion of marriage, and then moving on to again talk about the promise of marriage. Lord, you put these words in our hearts, and you put the scriptures in our mouths, so that way people could hear and receive with open hearts what you, your Holy Spirit, would have to say to them. I ask that you please let your word bear fruit. Draw people to you. In spite of the distractions of the day or the trouble in this world, we know that there's nothing impossible with you. And we know that nothing can separate us from your love.
Hallelujah.
We praise you. We thank you for this endless love series. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. All right. What's the first? You are what? You are the love of my life. You are the hope that I cling to. You mean more than this world to me. I wouldn't trade you for silver or gold. I wouldn't trade you for riches untold. You are my everything.
You are the love of my life. You to you mean more than this world to me. I wouldn't trade you for silver or gold. I wouldn't trade you for riches untold. I wouldn't take one step without you. I could never go
I could never go on, no, no.
I couldn't live one day without you. I don't have the strength.
I don't have the strength. You are the love of my life.
Yes, you are.
You are the hope that I cling to.
You
mean more than this world to me. I wouldn't trade you for silver or gold. I wouldn't trade you for riches untold.
You are
my everything.
Thank you. Have a good night, everyone.
Awesome. Woohoo!